Alright, Shalom Rastafari. Okay, we're going to testify to something, and it's only because, we're going to testify to our experience, and it's only because, you know, give thanks to Wendem Mandela, Haile Jesus. We were conversing on the phone, and we declared this, what we're about to declare, right? And because of the reasoning, we concluded that we'll bring it forth. Alright, this may confuse some people, but this may really clarify things to other people. You know, we really can't say. All right, so we'll say that from our birth, we're sure that we were well acquainted with God and knew that He was with us. We say that because you know, during our childhood, we had a lot of nightmares. And within these nightmares, we would battle it out every night. And we weren't scared. We wouldn't not try to go to sleep. We really didn't care what it was. And we just knew that, you know. But we didn't think much of it. It's a matter of once you're asleep and you start having the nightmare, it's like, you know, here we are again. And so you know, what's it going to be this time, really? And so, you know, during these confrontations, these nightmares and stuff like that, we would declare our alliance to the Almighty and that He defended us and that nothing could ever do anything to us, to harm us. Because in most of these cases, in most of the nightmares, at least the few that we have a little remembrance of, we would be aware of this being a dream. We would be very well aware of us being asleep and having this nightmare vision. And it's in some cases our attempt would be to wake up, but not in all cases was that possible. And in some cases, we would wake up only to be in another dream, right? Not to get into all of that, we can't say that we even remember much of it. But in certain situations, we would confront the enemy straight on and declare that God was with us and that there's nothing that the enemy could do to us and and stuff like that, right? So we only say that because from that point on, we're gonna guess or assume that from the age 7, maybe 6, 7, 8, 9, lost. We don't know what happened, but our consciousness left. It fell asleep. We got into so much trouble growing up, and every time they would ask us why we did something, we would have no answer because we didn't have like a little angel and a little devil on our shoulders. You know, everything we did, it just kind of like happened. Well, there's a lighter. The lighters cause fire, and here's a paper, you know, don't ask me why I did that, it's only logical, right? Fire causes paper to burn, and we tried it out, and it burnt, right? So that was our approach, and so, like, for some reason, our perspective on God was negative. We completely rejected the idea. Well, attempted to reject it, you know, but even taking on the idea implies that the idea exists. But we were completely against religion and pretty isolated and against Jesus Christ and all that stuff because we weren't stupid. We, even though we were like completely dead, we saw what was going on in the world, and we knew that that was hypocrisy and ignorance and dumb to think that that was of God. And so people, you know, they believed in, well, they pretended to believe, and we saw their actions. We saw what went on in church and stuff like that. We didn't even though we didn't know a whole lot of anything, we knew that that was BS, that that was a lie. And it's interesting because we didn't even, now that we recall, we don't even know any reason why we would think such a way, but rather that in our hearts, we just did not accept that in any way whatsoever. And so we grew up kind of like hating the idea of God and blaming all things on God, and using the reality of the world as the premise to our conclusion. And it was a pretty good premise, and it was a fairly logical conclusion that if everyone claims to believe in this man named Jesus and the world is this effed up, then obviously this man Jesus isn't, you know what, all that people make him out to be. So in time we learned that we weren't that wrong. But so we grew up pretty upset and stuff like that. And then, you know, we really held on to this one thrash metal band named Slayer. And the reason we really enjoyed it is because they disrespected the idea and concept of God to its fullness. But they would give support. They would give supporting evidence to their perspective. And so, like, the lyrics would back up what they said. And the lyrics that were being written by them were, in fact, like, a testimony of the reality of what's in this world. And so, to us, it was very real, very true. And one thing that Kerry King, the guitarist, lead guitarist, he would always say, you know, think for yourself, you know? And he would say, God hates us all. And he would say, you know, he's pretty straight up on what he accepts, and he does not accept a God and stuff like that, because he is still choosing to view the world from the negative that it is, from the evil that it is, right? But we've moved on. But you know, for the purpose of bringing forth this testimony, we'll continue explaining that. And so we really related to this group. The vocals and bassist was Chileño from Chile. His last name is Araya, which is interesting because it has to do with Re'i, with vision, with Araya in the Amareña. Another guitarist was German. The drummer was Cuban. And so the other guitarist, which we spoke of, Kerry King, is from LA, so straight up like American. But nonetheless, that group of people like influenced I and I in so many different ways, and at least we got the message that think for yourself, don't listen to what other people think or do, you know, be yourself and stuff like that. And then alongside with the disrespecting or blaspheming God, but really what we learned is that they too were kind of like doing kind of like right in a sense. But before we get to that, okay, so we'll explain why this isn't all that wrong, because this Jesus is not real. That whitewashed image of a beast, Cesar Borgia, is not the real Christ. And so definitely, yes, this world is all messed up because everyone's following the image of a beast, not true and living God, you know, Yeshua HaMashiach, you know. And so Iyesus Kristos, yes, it's the Christ. And so it all made sense, you know, but that was later on. So it all had to do with the reggae music. We started listening to some reggae, and it's like, kind of like, okay, that's positive. Years go by. You know, we suffer, we die. And during our death, you know, reggae, we become closer to reggae. And we notice that it's very positive. And so, and we still listen to Slayer, right? But now we have something in our lives that kind of like balance things out. So now we begin to notice that reggae seems awfully positive. And so, like, years pass, we're still dead, and we start noticing that some of the things that were being sung sounded a whole lot Christian and godly. So whatever, right? Time goes on, and then we were introduced to the movie Rockers, and we're like, what? People live a certain way, and they praise this person as God, and reggae has everything to do with it. And so we asked our friend, and we're extremely proud of him and thankful that he is now bassist for, and you know, a coming band, Tribal Seeds, which keep reggae. They present it in a Southern California style, but still they maintain the word of truth, you know, including His Majesty in within the lyrics and proclaiming the truth of Yesu, even Yesu's and all that is of Rastafari. And so we give thanks and praise for that. And so we asked him, Shamu, his name's Victor, right? So we asked him, why do people say that he's God? And in a point in time where we were suffering our death and going through the death, or coming out of the death, maybe, you know, seeking for starting to want to seek for something true, he answered, because he is, and we accepted that to be. Still, we don't know anything about Rastafari, and we care not, or we're beginning to care. So now, time passes, and we're kind of coming out of Sheol, of the underground, and, seeking, like, really tired of everything, just desiring, like, anything different than this world, because we dreaded every single day of existence upon this place we called a planet. So now, once we realized that there was kind of like a culture to reggae, and that it meant something, and that this man, Haile Selassie I, is considered God, and we too accepted him with no evidence to be God, just because we just wanted anything other than the whole Cesar Borgia image of a beast, white Christ, and, you know, white supremacy and all that stuff. And so we go on forward, but then it gets more, we start learning about him, right, about His Majesty, but then it gets really intense, and we're really to the point where we're not going to kill ourselves, because we ain't done nothing wrong, and that's definitely not in our minds. We actually enjoy ourselves, but we're sick and tired of this world. Something better happen, right? And so we so extremely desperate, to the point where we mentioned at a friend's house, his mom said something about a church reunion for young people, and we were like, we'll go, completely defeated, just, you know, fuck it, we'll go, you know, that's how it was. And we were looking straight down at the floor, and we're kind of like tired of this world, right? We're all like, we'll do it, you know, we'll go against everything we ever stood for. We've hated that church, we've hated this idea of a white Jesus and stuff like that, but we'll go, you know, at this point we'll try anything. And we even declared that to her. We said, honestly, this is like the last thing we would ever have desired to have done, but at this point, who cares, you know, we'll try it. It's funny, it works. It turns out that Josh set it up so that we weren't able to go. In all sincerity, we got called up for work and we had to go. And so two friends end up going, right? But this was a sign that Jah the Almighty was like, all right, this guy really, he's down, you know, he's willing to go to that extent to, you know, to try something different. And so from then on, everything just kind of like came together, slowly but surely. And so Jah basically said, nah, this one I'm going to set aside to myself, and I ain't gonna allow him to become broken before I even fix him. You know, entering one of these churches, any church really, it helps people in different stages during their lives. But when it comes to being Jah's soldier, to be the man, you know, the call man, the those called, you know, to fulfill a mission, to complete a mission, those really like the high-ranking, like, officials of the Almighty, yeah, the church has nothing to do with any of these elect. And so Jah's all like, he ain't fixed yet, I ain't gonna allow him to get broken up in these false institutions. And so, like, he did not allow that to happen, But forward, well, it all started coming together, and then we started studying, and behold, we go on YouTube, and Racia Dinos Teferi, Racia Danos Tefara, Wendem Yadon, you know, we hear him on YouTube, and he starts to teach Christ, Yeshua, Jesus, the Ethiopian, the true Christ, and we're like, we're kind of like, we didn't know what to think about that, but we were quick to act on it, and so we were at work, even during lunch, we stepped out, we went to a Dollar Tree, it's a 99-cent store right across from where we worked, and we bought a dollar Bible. Why? Because Racia Dinos Teferi was testifying that Ethiopia was in the Bible and that Christ was Ethiopian, that is Ethiopian, and well, making all those connections, you know, and with His Majesty being the Father of Ayindai, Abat Edus, or Abat Achin, our Father. And so, like, we're all like, we gotta check this out, see if it's true. And we get home, we're all eager. Keep note that we've never read a book in our lives. And the Bible was the first book that we picked up and actually read, or begun to read, and far from reading, study, right? So we've never read before, much less study, but the Bible was the first book, you know, and we give thanks and praise to, you know, Racia Dinos Teferi, our brother Yadon, for introducing Christ Jesus to us, and which is, you know, unspeakable. Nonetheless, going forward, we get home and we start reading, and second chapter, Ethiopia. From the garden went a river. And, you know, the second was called the Gihon. The same is it that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia. We'll look for that. So, yeah, so it's on the second chapter, verse 13. And the name of the second river is Gihon. The same is it that compasses the whole land of Ethiopia. And so it was a dollar Bible, like a cheap one and whatever. And so it was in the first page. Chapter 2 was in the first page. And we're like, we kind of got all joyful and went up to our guardian mother. And we're all like, it's the first page and Ethiopia is already in the Bible. This just got to be true. And so slowly but surely it became what it is now, and it is true. And then, I mean, just Psalm 87, you know, in Ethiopia, this man is born there. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to just figure out that this man is born in Ethiopia. The Highest Himself shall establish her. Behold, Philistia, behold, Tyre. In Ethiopia, this man is born there, and the Highest Himself shall establish her, and I shall write up my people, that this man was born in, that this and that man are born in her, and stuff like that. Psalm 87, we haven't memorized it or anything, but it's all that's included in there. So nonetheless, we go, and actually, after reading the first page, we jumped forward to Revelations 5:5, and we were aware of that verse, but we had not actually looked and read it from a actual book in our hands. And so we read it, and it just kind of like confirmed everything from beginning to the end, from the end to the beginning. It's all the same. It's Ethiopia's Majesty is God Almighty, and Christ is His Son, Jesus, and stuff like that. And so, like, but we still hadn't received Christ then. So, like, we start studying, we start painting, and doing all things, you know, for His Majesty Most High. First, we got an inspiration of painting and art and drawing and all that stuff. And then we got And while we did that, we would listen to Yadon, Brother Yadon, on the YouTubes, like in the background. And once, like half a year, then we got inspired or motivated to study. And it was reading John. When Yeshua starts speaking, Jesus starts speaking on, you know, I told you this before it came to pass, so when it came to pass that you would believe. And I heard the voice of His Majesty, and I didn't hear a voice. You know, I just, you know, you remember, like things you've heard and stuff like that. Just like you remember a party, this is how that came. Alright, so nothing came out of the sky and stuff like that, right? None of that foolishness or confusion. But we heard His Majesty tell us these things, and then Jesus says, and I told you that this would happen before it come to pass, or when it come to pass, that you would believe. And then I'm all like, oh, okay, so now we see His Majesty doing these other things, and that's when we were in our beds, we jumped up and started running. Yeah, that's what we did, and like joyfully, and after that we broke down and cried and stuff like that. But that was from then on. We were sure that we had received Iyesus Kristos. That was our anointing, right? And so, because John was seemed to be like easy for us to understand. It all made sense, like easily, like very clearly, as to the other gospels. But it's because of the nature of the situation. It doesn't make one better than the other, but the Gospel of John is very, if you've been a part of truth, you know, preordained and stuff like that, then you just know it, you feel it, because that's you. Nonetheless, the reason we bring forth this testimony is because we, you know, people struggle with the first advent, second advent, the first coming, second coming. Well, this is our experience. And our testimony and the truth that we've been given. The first coming for I and I was His Majesty Most High upon the throne of Solomon, son of David, upon the throne of the Davidic dynasty set up in Ethiopia through Solomon Makeda of Ethiopia and Solomon of Jerusalem and Makeda Sheba of Ethiopia in their unification and the fruit of that communion, Menelik, Dawit the first. Thus, you know, the kingdom of the throne of David set up in Ethiopia, you know, to be carefully protected for and concealed to be a living revelation, a testimony to the things that have always been and stuff like that. So basically the Empire of Ethiopia hidden away from the evil curiosities of the world, preserved for these last days to be a living testimony, living witness to the things that are, you know, and stuff like that. Everything set up so perfectly so that just about the time that the technology, worldly technology, allowed for the mountains of, for the natural barrier, which would be the highlands of Ethiopia, the mountains of Ethiopia, when it was possible that these evil curiosities of the world, through its acquisition and advancement in sciences and technology, right about that time, that would allow for them to penetrate these natural barriers, which preserved carefully for 2,000 years the kingdom of Ethiopia, the throne of Solomon, the throne of David upon the land of Cush. When it was that time, it was exactly that same time when the child to revere, behold, is born in her, in Ethiopia. And the Highest Himself, the anointed, unbegotten Haile Selassie, first, the mighty power of the Trinity, when he becomes King of Kings and heir to the throne of David and sits upon that throne through Solomon and Sheba and all that fulfillment, you know, we kind of lost track, but that all ties in, right? But the first coming is the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah, God Almighty, the Father. So when we start learning about the Father said, worship, adore my Son. we couldn't understand. You know, so the Christ first coming in our experience in truth and in spirit is I, Father Majesty, the King of Kings of Ethiopia, the conquering land of the tribe of Judah, Haile Selassie first, His Imperial Majesty. You know, God's elect, Earth, the rightful ruler. But then God Almighty said that you gotta go to my son, you gotta go to Jesus. And we did not understand that. We knew he was God, and we said, who cares about this Jesus figure? We still had not learnt like the fullness of it, right? This is before the anointing, if we recall correctly. And so we couldn't understand that. It was a stepping stone, but at that time a stumbling block. Why does he talk about Christ? Why does everything that His Majesty ever says or does, or why does everything have to lead to Iyesus Kristos? And then once we studied, because it had to be so, because the Father giveth all things to the Son. For those that were the Father's were given to the Son and kept in the Father's name. Behold, Rast Eferi, Rastafari, be it those people, you know, and I be that people, you know. And so that was the first coming. But then with the anointing, we received Christ Jesus in spirit, you know, anointed with clarity all things and understanding, and here we are. And so to us personally, His Majesty Most High, Ababa Janhoi, you know, the elect of God, conquering land of the tribe of Judah, King of Kings of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie first, to us came as the first advent upon the throne of great King David. And then, once we became learnt, Jesus, the Son of the Almighty, Bein Ha Elohim, came secondly. Spirit of Christ, Jesus, was the second advent. And so, you know, we bring this forth because it might explain a lot of things to a lot of people. Father declared the Son, and all things be given to the Son. And likewise, no man can go to the Father but through the Son. So it's pretty interesting how it happened. But yeah, I guess to sum it all up, His Imperial Majesty, first advent, Christ resurrected in I, the second coming, in the spirit and in truth. Shalom.